Good evening, and I'd like to call the November meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to order. To begin the meeting, first of all, I'd like to review the minutes of our previous meeting from October 20th of this year. Does anyone on the board have any comments, clarifications, or corrections? No? A motion?
Motion that the minutes be approved as submitted. Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Thank you very much. Before beginning new business, I'd like to note at this time correspondence that has been received by the Planning Board with our information packages this month. First of all, we have a copy of the Zoning News of October 1998. We also have a copy of Shoreland Zoning News for summer and fall of 1998, an article entitled Collaborative Planning for Infill Development, a copy of the Planning Commissioner's Journal for fall of 1998, and the last item we received was an information article from Maine Department of Transportation entitled Transportation Planning and Project Programming in Maine. Those items being received, we can move on to new business. And the first order of new business this evening is the Jones Public Access Waiver Amendment, a request by Tom and Lisa Jones for an amendment to a previously approved public access waiver to expand the building envelope to accommodate the existing location of the structure at 251 Spurwink Avenue. This would be reviewed under section 19-4-2B of our pre-June 1997 zoning ordinance. So if the applicant could come to the podium and tell us just a little bit about what's involved, we'd be happy to hear about it.
Thank you. My name is Paul White, and I'm a builder, and I'm here representing Tom and Lisa Jones. I did submit a letter and a plan explaining the situation. The plan shows that the building, the backside of the garage, did find its way out of the building envelope. And to rectify that, we have enlarged the building envelope a little and allowed for the bank to give them a mortgage.
Okay. Thank you very much. The task before us here is really an amendment to a public access waiver, which does not require a finding of completion or a public hearing. So I guess at this point in time, the board could begin discussion directly on consideration of the application and any questions that they may have. Does anybody want to? Yes, Tom.
Mr. Chairman, through the chair, ask Maureen. I don't recall this this coming before the board, but it certainly has within my duration here. It seems the thing that seems extraordinary to me in the request is the fact that the suggested expansion of the building envelope, as depicted on the plan that you've submitted, appears to be almost 50% of the existing building envelope. And what I'm going to ask the planner is, the existing building envelope doesn't seem, the orientation and its layout doesn't seem tied to anything. How was that originally created?
This has actually been to the board twice before. The second time that Jones brought it to the board, and I believe that question was asked by you at that time. And
there's two strikes.
And the only way it was tied was that there was a dimension between the property line and the original building envelope. Further, the envelope was drawn by the applicant after advice to make sure they drew something that would accommodate the house. So apparently there was every intention of putting the house in at an angle, and at some point it got twisted around, so obviously it popped outside the building envelope. The problem, I spoke to the code officer about this, and his feeling is that unless he has a surveyed line and a surveyed building envelope line so that he actually can check them out in the field, which doesn't happen now, he's not willing to confirm that a house is inside a building envelope because he doesn't know where the lines are to measure from.
No, I understand that. It would seem that there's a couple of things missing on this plan. The building envelope and the right-of-way for the driveway don't touch, so presumably you would have to clear to get the driveway into the building site. So if the plan is going to be amended, that depiction should be placed on the plan as well. My comment would be, if the existing building envelope is so small, and I apologize for not recalling why it was sized the way it is, but it would seem to me quite extraordinary to take such an enlargement for what is a fairly small garage, that's going outside the existing envelope. For lack of any other suggestion, it appears to me that this property is backing up to several existing house lots, and I couldn't tell from the location map which side street this is. These house lots are on. Is that Eastman Drive?
Pleasant.
Pleasant. That is this site wooded?
Yes.
Between that, I would think that not less than a 30-foot buffer would want to be maintained between the existing residences and any building clearing or envelope. That would be rather than the 20 feet, which is suggested on the plan. And I guess what I'm suggesting, that either a line be made parallel to the northerly line that's existing, some reasonable distance from the garage, so that the garage, as it was built, is depicted correctly. You know, maybe it's 10 or 15 feet off the corner of the garage and parallel to the existing line. Otherwise, just offset at 30 feet or what's appropriate on the site, 30 feet from the common rear yard of the adjacent house lots. I assume this plan is being revised.
The plan has been revised.
If it's not approved by the board this evening, if there are suggested changes. The other, since we're commenting on it, the locus plan doesn't depict the nearest side street, whether it's the one to the south of the site or if Pleasant is the closest side street. I think it would be helpful in the locus plan to call out one of those street names. Is Eastman the street that's depicted on the locus plan? Running between Sawyer and Spurwink, do you know?
No, yeah, that must be it. Yes, that's it. Yep.
That was all I had.
Well, I have a question, Maureen. Could you tell us, do you know what the side or rear line setback is? Is this 20-foot dimension related somehow or other to our ordinance requirements for setbacks?
My expectation would be that the setback in this zone is 30 feet.
We asked the code enforcement, we asked Bruce, and he said it was 20 feet before we left the office that day.
Okay.
And that's, more or less what you had recommended, try to not limit the size of the building envelope, make it a little bit bigger, and go by that 20-foot setback.
Yes, I'll throw out a topic for consideration by other board members that building envelopes as they're presented to the board quite frequently are smaller than what would be allowed under the ordinance in terms of side setbacks, rear setbacks, or wetland setbacks. merely to give the board an idea in reviewing subdivisions or house lots in terms of approximately where a house would be located. However, given that the building envelope still as modified here is still well reduced, unless there are other things that are missing in terms of setbacks here from what would be allowed under the ordinance, I think that's an interesting topic for us to come to grips with, because building envelope doesn't necessarily mean the only place that work is allowed on a site. You can grade or do other things except build a building outside of the building envelope. And even then, building envelopes are sometimes really more of a convenience in sort of determining planning aspects of how neighborhoods are laid out. So I don't really see the a tremendous difficulty with adhering to setbacks contained in our ordinance on this modification. I don't know how other board members may feel.
Mr. Chairman, is that a question to the board?
Yes.
I think there's really another issue here. This is a small subdivision as such. There's two houses on a single lot, and the lot's been divided in two. At least that's the way it appears. I may not have the history exactly right, but when you have an existing established neighborhood and we have things like a 20-foot side yard setback, whether it's an impact on the existing houses, there's some nice infill housing. There's one on Route 77 that backs up to Sylvan Sites or Acres, the South Portland subdivision. And if you go through Sylvan Sites and you look through the yards to the new development, what you see is that those units are within 15 to 20 feet of the existing lot line. There's no privacy in the new units, and there's lost privacy in the existing units. So regardless of what the building setback is, unless there's no reasonable room left on the site, I think any time you get a building within 20 feet of a lot line, it's in a situation like this, usually it's not a good situation. And unless there's some compelling reason, and obviously they haven't put the building within 20 feet, but then to clear within 20 feet of the lot line, I don't think is either good for the existing residents, unless they can demonstrate otherwise, nor for the existing buildings. I think there are slightly different expectations when you're in a more of an undeveloped lot like the ones you see that are come in behind the established neighborhood. 30 feet may sound like a lot if you start counting ceiling tiles and looking at 30 feet inside, but if you go outside and you stand in someone's living room and look across their rear yard and then put an orange flag or something 30 feet beyond that property line, you'll see that it's not very much. And then if you clear everything except and leave 30 feet of buffer, you'll also see that 30 feet of mature tree stand isn't really a lot relative to the large size of these two lots that are part of this development.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would like to add that there is kind of a natural buffer there. There's a stone wall, which is depicted on the plan, that is at one elevation, and then the house lots are actually a much lower elevation on Pleasant Street. So there is kind of a natural buffer with that in the woods. So even if the house was built, which they have no plans on doing, up to 20 feet, you still have the woods, and the change of elevation would be more of a natural buffer. But, you know, yeah. If the board decides to go with 30 feet, the Joneses can live with that. It's not a situation where they want to build more buildings there. They have what they want. They like the buffer of the woods there, too.
Sounds.
But we just went by what the ordinance called for.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Maybe we need a point of clarification here as well. Is this building envelope construed also to be the limit of clearing? So this there's nothing on this plan that depicts where the tree line is, so there's, you know, it's very difficult for us to make any determination. Well, if there's no constraint in terms of the clearing limit, then I think maintaining a 30-foot buffer would be advisable along the property line. Otherwise, there should be plenty of sunlight into this property. House is actually oriented quite well to take advantage of the sun.
Any other comments or approaches?
Just one last comment. There needs to be a geometric, if the code enforcement officer has trouble determining where he is in the field with respect to the building window or envelope, there's nothing on this plan other than the 20-foot offset proposed that tells you where you are geometrically on the site. There should be either some offset from the driveway right-of-way line that seems to be laid out fairly well, or some dimension along the property line. And then a bearing along with the distances provided, in which you've got is something just floating, purely floating in space with no way to determine where it is. Either that or tie it to a couple of the buildings.
Mr. Chairman?
You know, since you're going through the process of having to redraft this to resubmit it, might as well tie it up.
Well, the original subdivision plan that was approved by the board, the public access waiver plan, did include ties along the stone wall, and they're still there now. The 492 feet to an iron pipe at Spurwink Ave, and then further back it's 593 feet to Spurwink Ave. Those dimensions were related to the ties on the original plan. When the surveyor did the amended part of it, the proposed part of the building window, he took off those lines that went back, which did tie in the building. I didn't ask him to take those off, but he took them off. But at what would be right angles to the, I'm pretty sure it was right angles to the building window, is the way you develop those ties to Spurwink Avenue.
You understand the irony that we would approve, not a variance, but we would expand the building envelope with a document that has less information to tie the building envelope down, and the same mistake would be made tomorrow. Nobody would know the difference.
Well, the building is there.
I understand that, but the envelope that's shown on the plan isn't tied to the building. It isn't tied to the property line. It's not given a bearing. There's no way of knowing. If I walked out in the field with $2 million worth of survey equipment, I couldn't locate that anywhere on the face of the earth, at least based on the drawing that's in front of us. It's floating in space. It's an 80-foot by 120-foot rectangle.
Right.
Unless I take a scale and measure the plan, which you're never supposed to do on a surveyor's plan, you're supposed to have the information. I'm not criticizing you, and I'm not trying to make this difficult. I'm just pointing out that if we're going to amend the plan, we should have the geometric controls on the plan so that the mistake doesn't happen again. Or if it does happen again, for whatever reasons, if the owner wanted to expand the house, the owner, you, or a future contractor know where they are in the face of the earth with respect to the building envelope. And the code enforcement officer can go onto the site and find himself or herself on the site with respect to both the building, the property line, and the building envelope.
I can have the surveyor put back those lines that were on the original plan. And so when it's recorded, there will be some...
Well, let me ask you the question directly. You as a builder, how would you find where that building envelope is on the face of the earth based on... If we both have the same plan.
Right. This plan that's before us now?
Yes.
Yes, I agree with you.
Okay.
But I am willing to have the surveyor put those lines back on so that we can tie the lot into the property line.
Okay. And I would imagine the code enforcement officer would like some ties to the existing foundation corners to...
That's the only way he's going to be able to do it, because there's nothing that says that the property line is exactly the stone wall. You know, we talked about this, because the planning board approves building envelopes all the time, and I told him that you were kind of concerned about making sure buildings ended up in the building envelope, and his feeling is he's unwilling to certify that things are in the building envelope, because there isn't enough information out in the field when he checks to be able to determine that.
Each corner of the building envelope should be tied to two different building corners. What I see a lot is one dimension from a building corner to another, to the building envelope corner, or there's a line from a building corner perpendicular to the building envelope, but nothing, it all kind of floats and can be moved, you know, depending on how one swings a tape. So if you make triangles to each one of those dimensions, each one of those corners will be tied down. This is not an unusual situation in construction. It happens all the time. Houses don't end up on the right lots. The lots don't end up in the right places in the subdivision. The roads don't end up in the right place in the right-of-way line. And it's either lack of information on the plans initially, or it's an honest mistake in the field. And it's just the more information in the checks, you know, the better off everyone is.
I think in this case it was an honest mistake.
I don't question that at all. It happens all
the time. But there was enough information on the original plan. I hired a surveyor. We went out in the field and we located with stakes in the ground, and I was comfortable with those stakes until the excavator, you know, knocked them out. But again, if the board feels that it's necessary, I will put the dimensions on there that's needed. What you're suggesting is that I hire a surveyor to go out there and locate the ties, or can I measure from the property line ties to the foundation?
Well, the planner just told me that a meeting with the code enforcement officer indicates that he wants to have the corners of the building envelope tied to the building foundation, since the building's already in place. Is that correct?
That would be a good way to do it.
And what I have to do is locate the building window?
If there's got to be a way for him to feel certainty when he goes out in the field where the building envelope is. So either you have to tie it to the property line, and that way you're going to have to survey the property line so we know where that is located. It's probably going to be less expensive for you to tie it to the existing building, since you already know where the corners of the building are.
Right. So I can do that.
A surveyor has to do that.
The horse is starting to bloat and stink, but I'll ask one more question. Maureen said that you would have to survey the property line. Was the building not laid out based on the property line?
Yes, it was.
And so it's already been surveyed, and there should be some...
This plan is a recorded survey by Land Services, Inc. No. Survey, Inc. Sorry.
So there wouldn't be any problem establishing a 30-foot offset if we want to maintain a 30-foot buffer along the property line, so that we know where that, so you can locate that in the field as well. Concern with just using the building corner is that if the building is in someone else's property, you'd show the building envelope relative to the foundation, but you'd never discover that the building was someplace where it doesn't belong. So I think both methods are appropriate. Is that clear, or is that?
It's
in the motion.
Oh.
Yes.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Thomas and Lisa Jones for an amendment to the previously granted public access waiver located at 251 Spurwink Avenue be granted subject to the following condition. One, that a copy of the approved plan be recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. Two, that a 30-foot buffer be maintained along the existing sideline. And three, that the building envelope be accurately delineated on the plan, tied both to the buildings and to the 30-foot side yard setback from the property line.
discussion on the motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Could I request that a condition be made that you approve it pending I get this information to Maureen? I mean,
That's what this will do.
You don't have to come back.
Excuse me?
That's what this motion will do.
Okay. So I don't have to come back before another...
I'm not asking you to come back again.
I don't have to come back before another planning board meeting?
No, I wouldn't do that to you.
Thank you. Yes. Would you recognize Lisa, please? Lisa Jones is the owner.
Oh.
What's the buffer between the garage and the building?
It's 40 to 50 feet, somewhere in there. Closer than 30.
Okay.
Well, the approved envelope was at least 60, so it's only half of the previously approved envelope, except for the very corner where it was 20, but in the location where the garage is, the original envelope was set back almost 60 feet.
Now, what I hear you saying is that the 30-foot offset will run parallel to the property line?
That's correct.
To the property line?
Yes.
Okay.
I have a question. After our discussion of tying this envelope down to the face of the earth, it seems to me like the discussion that we just had stated that this envelope can be tied down without doing meets and bounds of the building envelope. Is that the way other board members heard that discussion? Or was I incorrect in just thinking that it sounded like we could just sort of triangulate off of a point on the sideline that was surveyed to yield the building envelope from there? I think that the board doesn't really need to go into the realm of requiring all building envelopes to have meets and bounds and then maybe monuments and God knows what. As we go down the road, there should be a way of doing this so that we don't make all our applicants go through that process. And it sounded to me in the discussion we just had
to the contrary.
This is something that's a very simple triangulation off of the building with maybe one or two spots along the sideline identified.
But to the contrary, please understand that the applicant 90% of the time is not this individual. It's the developer or the builder who's doing the whole subdivision.
Yeah.
And the less information they have on the plan, the more we're going to end up with the second parties having to come back with amended plans. Mm-hmm. So if it requires having offsets from property lines and meets and bounds to tie this down so the code enforcement officer can find it, so homeowners can find it, that may sound like a lot, but believe me, the banks will thank us, the attorneys probably will thank us, and certainly the people that end up buying the houses will be very grateful, and I think the builders will be grateful because everything's on a plan, it's clear and it's concise. We see this every day in our business, and it never stops, and Steve will reflect the same thing. I'm sure you've seen it, you know, in doing houses, so it may sound like a lot, but it sure makes life easier and for everyone in the field.
Any further discussion on the motion? Hearing none, I would ask that all those in favor of approval indicate by raising your right hand. We have an approved motion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda this evening is the Thomas Memorial Parking Lot Expansion, a request by the Town of Cape Elizabeth for site plan review to construct a new parking lot adjacent to the library at 6 Scott Dyer Road to be reviewed under Section 19-9, Site Plan Completeness and Public Hearing. The applicant should step up and tell us a little bit about the project.
John Jacobson with Post Associates in South Portland, Maine, and I'm here actually representing the town of Cape Elizabeth. for the Thomas Memorial Library parking lot expansion. What I first do is locate where the project is relative to Scott Dyer Road, Route 77, Ocean House Road. Thomas Memorial Library, we're just to the east of that. Now, the purpose of this project was to meet an existing demand for parking for the library itself. What we've done is add 17 net spaces to the existing parking lot, as you see depicted on the plan. That 17 is a result of removing actually 4 of the existing parking spaces. Again, as a result of the total number of parking spaces, we're required to have a minimum of 3 handicap spaces, one of which is required by ADA to be a van accessible parking space. One of the goals, as we talked with the town, was to create a park-like setting. And that's one of the things we, to define that a little better, is to create a pedestrian-friendly atmosphere as much as possible, as you'd be able to with a parking lot. One of the things we've done is functionally allow the pedestrians to access in and out, as well as tie into some of the surrounding parcels, and maybe look into the future as how this ties in to the town center itself. And also with the planting materials that we've selected, with the texture, some of the habits of the existing and proposed planting materials, some of the decisions were based on that goal of creating the park-like setting. To go along with the pedestrian aspect, we've also introduced 3 separate sitting areas, which we've defined actually a space and added the amenity of a bench for a sitting area. Lighting also was introduced, and we tried to be consistent, or have been consistent, with the future town center project as far as the type of lighting and model that we've used, which is, again, a pedestrian-type lighting design. Is there any questions?
No, that's very good. Thank you. At this point, the first task for the board is to determine if the application is complete. Mr. Parker.
I'd like to make a motion. Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented for the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a site plan review of the expansion of the Thomas Memorial Library parking lot located at 6 Scott Dyer Road be deemed complete. Okay. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Any questions by board members about any of the items of the application in terms of their completeness? Yes, Tom.
We have a letter. I'm not sure this was mentioned, but we have a letter on the podium this evening from the town manager regarding financial capability.
Yes.
And I think what that letter says, I'm not trying to be contentious here. I think what the letter says is that the project has been approved by the council to fund the engineering, that there is certainly the assets and the capital wherewithal in town government to pay for such a project. It's just a matter of whether or not it's on the priority for construction. Is that correct? What does that mean, Maureen, in terms of the approval?
Well, the town does a yearly budget, and I believe it's the manager's intention to add this project to the capital improvements program. And if it's approved by the council, then there would be funding for next year.
Okay. Obviously, it doesn't get billed if it isn't funded. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I have other questions, but they're not, they don't deal specifically with completeness.
Well, I think we need to just sort of establish whether or not the plan is complete first, unless the question is really procedural. Any other questions about items from the checklist or the sort of level of documentation provided by the applicant? Yes.
You had ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for site plan review of the expansion of the Thomas Memorial Library parking lot located at 66 Scott Dyer Road be deemed complete.
Okay.
Did not Mr. Parkhurst just make that motion?
Yes, sir. That's
I did.
Oh.
That is the motion on the table at this time.
I thought you
any further discussion on the motion? Seeing and hearing none, I would ask that all those in favor of the motion indicate so by raising your right hand. Motion carries. The application is deemed complete. At this point now, we can begin the discussion of subsequent review of the application. And the first thing that we should probably decide, and we probably cannot deal with this evening, would be whether or not a public hearing is desirable or necessary for this project.
At the workshop, the planning board instructed me to advertise a public hearing for this evening, so you actually could open a public hearing right now if you want to.
Okay. So, since we have already decided to have a public hearing and have it advertised for this evening, at this point in time, I will open our public hearing. Would anyone from the audience care to step up to the podium and give us your name and where you live and tell us any information you'd like to give us about this project?
And my name's Jerry Murray, and I believe that I'm the only resident about it. I'm to the south of the project. I'm a little disheartened that my garden's going to be paved, but I've watched the library, the lack of parking for 30-odd years, and your information, that land is always used with an agreement with my aunt to park some of the library parking there years and years and years ago for $1 a year. I am in favor of the project. I think it's a good use of an inevitable piece of property. I've had numerous conversations with the town manager, the planner, the project engineer, and I've had concerns about stormwater runoff, lighting, and naturally the buffering of cars in my front yard. But I think they've answered all my questions. And as I said before, I think it's going to be a good project. I'm in favor. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else care to share thoughts or ideas on this application with the board at this time? Please step up to the podium, and we'd be happy to hear you. Seeing and hearing no one else coming forward, I'll close the public hearing. And now the board can resume discussion of the project. Does anybody have any questions? Yes, Tom.
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of questions. What is the parking situation now? Is typically the number of spaces that are proposed, are they tied in any way to the zoning requirement for this lot? I mean, for the for the building, or are they, is this just simply trying to get as many spaces, obviously, as possible within the land that's available? Is it, does this indeed intend to meet the long-range parking requirements for the library?
I think this, go ahead, Maureen.
If you don't mind, the library director spoke with me this morning about exactly that issue, and he was asking what the zoning requirements are, and we came up with a couple of issues. The most important one is that library experience, in his opinion, the library experiences a severe lack of parking when they have functions at the library, when they have programming at the library. So when they have meetings in their conference room, when they have children's reading hour, that's when they run out of parking, and people are parking in places that are not library parking. The one issue we came up against was that the parking, there's no specific parking requirement for libraries in our ordinance. There's a parking requirement for municipal uses, and that parking requirement is 1.25 spaces per employee plus one space per 150 square feet of public assembly area. And his feeling was that there are times when you really ought to look at the entire library as a public assembly area, rather than, say, just calculating the public assembly area as the conference rooms. So there hasn't been a clear comparison between, as far as I know, unless John has done something, between our current zoning requirements and what they have for parking. It's just been an empirical observation that they run out of parking whenever they have any kind of significant programming.
Is there any shared parking that goes on with that front parking lot at the middle school? Is that one of the lots that's used?
It has always been a serious effort on the part of the library and its employees to limit that area to just library employees and patrons. There has often been issues with people from middle school using that area for parking. In particular, according to the library director, parent volunteers. However, they really are trying to discourage that and leave the parking just for the library patrons.
There's several spaces striped out along Scott Dyer Road as you enter the parking lot just to the left. It appears as though that's to allow access for the adjacent parking area. Is that indeed the case?
What you see depicted there on the plan, and also on the existing conditions plan,
mm-hmm.
which is labeled C100, that's actually an existing condition that functions, just as you said, for access into this parking for the McCullum property. So that is an existing condition. We're not proposing anything different there right now.
Is it really necessary that all of that area be striped out? Is there not enough backup room between? Because it appears as though those cars park right against the face of the building. If there were a 24-foot, if there were, similar to what you've already done, a driveway to let cars in there, so that there could be several spaces gained there as well.
Mr. Ammer, mm-hmm. again. I've worked with the town engineer on the town center sidewalk project, and that specific question was one that we looked at. First of all, right now, if you look in that area, there's on the westerly side of the curb cut for the library, it's basically an open paved area from that point all the way to the McCullum's building. And as part of the sidewalk project, we've worked with the property owner, the McCullum building, and have agreed that they would be closing off their curb cut and that we would provide them access through the library curb cut. The reason that makes sense is because there is not enough room on the McCullum property for people to back up without crossing over into the library. And in fact, there was an attempt several years ago to further delineate those two properties, and it didn't work. And the McCullum, the people who own that building are concerned that their patrons are elderly and need some room to move their cars, and they want to be able to preserve those spaces right up next to the building.
Okay. Thank you. Would you describe what happens? You mentioned that there's no curbing on the site, and your stormwater report mentions. Would you just describe where the stormwater is going and what happens to that which ends up in a catch basin?
Okay, if you look at the pre and post development, which you referred to in the report, what we have defined are two separate watersheds, both existing pre and post development. And what we're proposing is that the existing watershed to the west has encroached in this direction, which again, I think addresses some of Mr. Murray's concerns as far as the stormwater condition here right now, which we have decided, or the town has agreed that is a separate issue. But again, it did influence some of the decision on the proposed grading. What has happened is we end up with a grade break pretty much at the 15-foot setback along the edge of the parking lot, so that essentially the bulk of the runoff is going to that catch basin. And based on the calculations you see in the report, it's not to the extent where it will influence any proposed additions to the existing stormwater structures.
Where does that stormwater flow from that catch basin? Does it flow down toward to the north, or does it flow over toward the middle school?
Right now, it heads towards the middle school.
So it goes down into
right.
That. Okay. The plan has several. These are, this is that pavement marking system that has been used on Baxter Boulevard, I assume.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the very dark areas depicted on the plan. Each one of those areas gets that type of treatment. What is the pedestrian circulation implied with that system? If I park in this back parking lot, none of that seems to link to the main link to the library. The main entrance is in the link, if I'm not mistaken. It sort of leads directly toward the handicapped space, but I mean, I think most people are going to head diagonally right for the link because that's where the main entrance is. I mean, I understand the idea of ceremonial, you know, doing things for ceremonial purposes and people crossing it right angles, and if that's the reason it was done that way, I don't have any problem with that. I'm just curious as to why it's delineated the way it's depicted.
Okay. I agree with what you say as far as the being at right angles. What we looked at is a couple of different scenarios to pick up the pedestrian coming out of this lot, and our concern in maybe locating it closer in proximity to the main entrance was that you would have more of the pedestrians in this area crossing the main access of the parking lot itself. We only have one ingress and egress, so that particular situation drove us to locate it to the north side of the ingress and egress to keep the pedestrian traffic away from people coming in and out of that parking lot. And then at least giving them a visual contact with any vehicles, whether they be entering or exiting in this area. There's much more area to see anybody coming as far as viewpoint.
Would you not want that to go straight across the parking lot then and tie in and maybe use that as one of the access lanes for the new handicap parking layout?
Definitely could be considered. And to get back before I forget, not to change the subject, but you mentioned the pattern paving that we're talking about. I did bring along, we've talked about different scenarios, and that is what we're showing on the plan. And what it is specifically is bituminous pavement, and you'll see an example of it here in the picture. That is just one color that they offer, and the color that we're showing is specking out as terracotta. What you'll see is the texture is limited to within this area right here. What we've done is we are staying consistent with the color in the existing paved area, but we are not proposing that we cut that existing pavement and then introduce this pattern. We have only carried through the color, not the texture, in the existing paved area.
I see.
So doing what you proposed definitely could work.
Could you pass that around, please?
I have just a couple more comments. It sounds like there's been an awful lot of discussion and work behind this in staff meeting. I drove on my way here this evening. I made the enormous effort to drive by there and take a look. And particularly since I was so early to get here, but clearly you're buffering Mr. Murray's property to the south. Was there any concern about buffering headlights shining into the office buildings to the east? If you stand in the parking lot and look across the existing parking lot and look across the sort of the middle of the proposed parking lot, you're looking right at the Thompson office building. Was that an issue?
I think that definitely was considered, and what we ended up was more of a filter. We had to be careful because we knew that this was one of the higher priorities, as you mentioned, with the residents over here, and then some of the buffering for people looking through here. Again, staying consistent with that park light design. What we had talked about is this use, as far as the office building, may not necessarily, the majority of it being during the night hours, so that the headlights that you speak of that may filter through here, in which we do have some existing you see on the plan, and we are proposing a couple in this area. So in combination with the existing proposed, and then if we look at what's going on and what hours of the day for this office, the attempt was made to address that.
And was there any discussion about putting some sort of decorative fencing between the drive to the east and the proposed parking lot, just to set it off, if you're creating this park-like effect? Not on the opposite side, on the east side. No, on the east side, to the right.
Okay. I don't recall that we discuss that, no.
People from driving over the lawn and out, taking shortcuts through there?
Across here?
Yeah.
I think if you look at as a finished product, the grades that will exist here, if you travel this route, that's at a maximum of 5%. So if somebody were to attempt to drive directly across, there's quite a grade difference. If you look at the elevation vertically between the edge of this pavement and this existing paved drive, is that your concern?
Yeah, I mean, so there's a lot of SUVs in greater, right, in Cape Elizabeth, and you know, people do anything. Right. They have the new turnaround at the Jetport, the dead end to Stroudwater, and people are jumping that curb all the time to get into the Jetport. And this would be a real convenient shortcut to cut through here and down the Bituminous Drive and down 77. The fence, to me, is more of a decorative issue. It sort of sets the area aside. The plants don't have to be so dense that you're creating a wall. You want it to be sort of a public park. The only other thing that I'm reviewing a project now where the applicant is using this material that was used at Baxter Boulevard, and an engineer has expressed concern about it being a slippery surface. I haven't taken the opportunity to walk to use a crosswalk at Baxter Boulevard, but I don't know if you've heard anything to that effect or not. It's the issue that they take the pavement and then they build up. The paint is actually some sort of it can be a slippery material unless there's an additive in it or something. You're talking about the same process where you emboss and then add layers of...
Now, there are some options as far as the finished product. And I think what you're speaking of is an acrylic product,
yeah,
which is applied after the bituminous has cured, and there are some concerns, and there has been some discussion to that effect, and we will keep close watch on that, whether it be the color or the texture. There are some additives. You know, it's simple. It was mentioned to even use some sort of sand material, some sort of commercial additive, which I know has been used around marinas and dock surfaces, that type of thing.
That's all. Thank you.
Are you talking the black or the red? The red.
And I think there are some color samples in there, and what we've specced out up till now is actually called terracotta, which is the red.
Well, it would be any one of these. And this is the something like the circle that's going to be in the middle?
Yes. That would be the pattern.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I think we waived the contour requirement, but I'm just a little curious to make sure that that private drive that's on the east side connects up to that walkway. I just wanted to know if, which direction the flow would be. Would that driveway tend to now drain into the parking lot? Is there any arrangements on that pathway that would eliminate that possibility, or is that a concern?
Again, I think we have taken into consideration this area, and as far as the grade break, there will be potentially, if I understand you right, the runoff in this direction.
It will go
towards the right, towards this. And what will happen is a separate project is that will have to be included when some decisions are made in this area. As far as the town addressing the drainage, the existing drainage problems in this area, is that correct? Maureen, that's what we have talked about.
But right, you're not adding drainage, though, because right now the break is basically down north-south, right, down through the middle of the site. So now the break will actually be shifted over, I don't know, 25 feet?
I would say. I'd estimate 20 to 25 feet.
And so 25 feet of drainage that currently heads towards that private drive is now going to be heading back towards the catch basin instead.
I have a question. Perhaps you can talk a little bit about the alignment of the sidewalk that heads off to the east. I noticed at the very back of our packages there was a more detailed plan of the parcel, of the Thompson parcel, to sort of give us some idea of what is at the end of that pathway. And I was just wondering, it seems that the alignment of the new sidewalk heading off to the east sort of is implying that we'll see some traffic sort of heading back to the town center, the traffic going up to town center. Is that what the,
right,
the plan
now
is? Or is there any possibilities at this point, because there is a connection through to Route 77 right now that actually cuts right, goes right through to Route 77 and to Ocean House Road that's shown on that Thompson parcel detailed plan. So is there any intention as to a future connection there, or are you trying to avoid a connection?
I just want to make sure we're looking at you're explaining an existing access in this area?
Yeah, there's a,
right,
a site plan of that parcel,
right,
and it kind of looks like if you look at that site plan and then look back at the parking lot plan, the new driveway is aligning with what are sort of two parking spaces for that complex, which are accessed only from the private road. And the new sidewalk sort of ends up right where those two parking spaces are.
Okay. What you see depicted on the plan right now is a result of a decision that is ongoing in this area right now. Mm-hmm. I think Mr. Murray talked about that a little bit as far as a drainage easement, and I hesitate to go into a lot of detail not knowing what the current status is. And again, I think that's what drove us. What you see here is, in fact, the attempt to tie in down the existing paved drive. Mm-hmm. And I think what you'll see in the letter that introduces this project is that upon approval of this, we'd like to reserve the right to right now even mirror this so that it does exactly what I think you're asking,
yeah,
to make it more functional to come across this way.
Yeah.
But right now there is nothing in place, and Maureen can go into more detail as far as allowing us to do that, if I'm correct. Right now, we're not able to have that access. Is that correct, Maureen?
Mr. Murray and the manager have been discussing it, but as the board is aware, we don't direct pedestrians onto private property unless we have an easement that allows public access. So while we all know that right now it's common practice for people to cut across the property that currently has the yoga building on it, we don't have any legal right for the public to cross over that property. The idea that's being discussed is to take care of the drainage by putting a pipe in that area, and that we would also get a pedestrian easement at the same time we did the drainage project. So the proposal that I had made is that if that happens, that the applicant would be allowed to realign that pedestrian walkway without coming back to the board for a site plan amendment.
Okay. Any further questions on the application? Does any board member feel the need to do a site walk? Being right next to the library parking lot, most of us have probably been there at one time or another, I would imagine. Yes, Mr. Parkhurst.
Let's make a motion.
Yes.
Findings of fact, number one, the town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting site plan review of the expansion of Thomas Memorial Library parking lot located at 6th Scott Dyer Road. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the November 17th, 1998 planning board meeting, at which time a public hearing was also held. Number three, public improvements adjacent to the project may make minor changes to the proposed plan advisable to promote more cohesive development of the town center district. Four, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plan's materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the town of Cape Elizabeth for site plan review of the expansion of the Thomas Memorial Library parking lot located at 6th Scott Dyer Road be granted subject to the following condition. Number one, that the easterly walkway and light fixtures may be changed to be consistent with the town center sidewalk project and a potential pedestrian easement.
Second.
I second that motion, please.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Mr. Emery.
I'd raise the question of a fence along the easterly side of the parking lot. Is that anything the board wishes to have added to the plan or suggest to the applicant?
I think I'd rather let that evolve on its own rather than do that now.
Mm-hmm. Any other board members have comment on the fence?
Mm-hmm. By evolve, you mean if there's a need for it, then it would be installed.
You know, if it seems in the future that would make more sense or prevents a problem or create something more desirable, than do it then.
As long as it's not a chain link fence.
Right.
Okay.
Any further discussion items or questions for the applicant? Hearing none, I'd ask that all those in favor of the motion indicate by raising their right hand. We have a unanimous approval. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is the Sprague subdivision master plan. This is a request by the Sprague Corporation for final subdivision approval of a 62-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road, reviewed under Section 16-2-4, parentheses C. This application has already received preliminary approval from the planning board back in the spring. And at this point in time, I'd ask that the applicant come to the podium and update us on status of the plan and issues for that have been incorporated into it since,
Mr. Chairman,
since then.
I'll recuse myself as I have in the past.
Very well, Mr. Henry. Welcome.
Good to be back. My name is Terry DeWan, I'm a landscape architect from Yarmouth, here on behalf of the Sprague Corporation. And we are here to start the process, hopefully a fairly short process, for final subdivision approval.
Maybe shorter than we thought.
And for wetland cultivation permit and approval for four private access way. As you know, on October the 30th, we submitted a rather long package that consisted of a number of drawings, I think 80 to be exact, certainly the record for our office for a subdivision approval. Plus a rather lengthy narrative, the final subdivision approval, narrative for drawings for the wetlands alteration permit, and information relative to the private access way. I don't really know how to go about doing this tonight. I think that according to Maureen's suggestion here, we should probably just do a very brief overview of where we're at right now and get on with the determination of completeness. We feel that we do have a very complete package. I hope that all of you have had a chance to review it. And going back to Maureen's memo of November the 18th, she does point out these four or five items that she feels need to be addressed in order for the board to deem this package to be complete. And what I'd like to do is to just go over those items and then address any questions that the board may have relative to the package as a whole. If the board determines that this is a complete package and we are, and you're willing and ready to go ahead with the start of the review, then we can start getting into the more substantive issues of the application package. But for right now, I guess I would like to address just the issues of the completeness that were contained in Maureen's memo.
That would be excellent.
As you know, we did receive preliminary subdivision approval back in June 17th of this year. And the first item, number one, of Maureen's memo, talks about some of the conditions of this preliminary approval may not have been fully complied with from the plan. This is a two-page letter that Mark Wilcox signed. It contained 9 different findings of facts and 8 different conditions. There are 2 points that Maureen points out that either have changed or we may not be in compliance with. The first is the note on condition number 4. For those of you who don't have the conditions of approval, let me read what that was. The note states that a note be added to the plan stating, quote, during the life of the Sprague Corporation, shareholders have the right to use the property pursuant to the terms of their shareholders' agreement, which will be available for use by family members. When we reread that note, we felt that the last 8 or 9 words were really redundant. And so we've simply abbreviated that note to read, during the life of the Sprague Corporation, shareholders have the right to the use of the property pursuant to the terms of their shareholders' agreement, period. That's the change we made to the map. For the plans. This, of course, is not strictly in compliance with the preliminary approval. We would like to have your approval to make that wording change just for clarity's sake and to eliminate the redundancy. The second point has to do with wetland mapping.
And point number five, the conditions of approval stated that revised wetland mapping were provided where wetland boundaries do not match wetland soil boundaries. We had Willot Alternatives go out and look at a couple of situations, especially at the end of Ice Pond Road, where there was some uncertainty relative to the extent of the wetlands and the extent of the RP1 wetlands in those areas. Maureen points out in her note of November 17th that the wetland soils mapping at the end of Ice Pond Road still does not include soil names in the area where the RP1 wetlands are identified. That is true that we did not have Albert Frick or any other wetland scientist go out and identify the soils. However, we did have a wetland scientist go out and identify the edge of the RP1 wetland. We are also going to have to make a minor adjustment to the 250-foot setback from those RP1 wetlands. But in our estimation, we have complied with the conditions of the preliminary approval to do the additional wetland mapping. The second point under the summary of completeness, that the survey provided by the applicants is not stamped or signed. Les Berry from DH2M is here to address any of the technical aspects of when a stamp or a signature is required. However, at this point, because we're simply submitting the application, this is not the final plan approved by the board. I'm sure there's going to be, after discussions with the board, some additional notes or comments that may be added. At that point, the copy that's given to you for your signature will be stamped and signed by a registered Maine surveyor. We don't want to have too many copies floating out there that either are incomplete or out of date, because that's the reason that we provide you with unsigned copies at this point. But one will be provided for the final application. Item number, this label is number four, I believe it's number three in the list. We've applied for but not yet received a DEP permit. Again, this is true. Back in August, Les Berry had a meeting with Mary Beth Hubert from the DEP talking about the stormwater management issue. If you recall, some of the earlier discussions that we've had several months ago had to do with how stormwater in a site immediately adjacent to the ocean and a relatively flat site interspersed with many, many wetlands that act as sinks. How do you treat stormwater management in a situation like this? It's a very unusual situation, one that while we are adding lots throughout the site, over 1,500 acres, the proportion of impervious surface that we are creating, the number of places that we're altering stream flows is very, very minimal. And so while we are asking for an approval that's probably out of the ordinary, the initial read that we got from DEP said that this certainly is the proper approach. We should not be looking for any type of stormwater detention basins on the property because they really simply are not needed in this situation, given the limited development patterns and given its proximity to the ocean. There really aren't any downstream abutters or property owners who would be affected by any minimal increase of stormwater. Normally, the stormwater permit takes 60 days to from the time that it's submitted to the time it's granted. By the time we come back before you, assuming we don't get through final approval tonight, by December 15th, we fully intend to have that DEP permit in hand. And if it is not in hand, we would like to make that a condition of final approval. On the next page, what's listed as item number five, the letter provided by the Portland Water District asserts adequate capacity to disturb the lots on Ice Pond Road. If you recall, those are the six lots off of Bowery Beach Road on Lot 2. We do have that letter from the Portland Water District. However, we also are proposing to extend a 4-inch line to lots 8-2 and 8-3, as well as lots 10-3 and 10-4 over here. That probably should be expanded to include lots 10-1 and 10-2 also. Lots 8-2 and 8-3 down here, lots 10-1 through 4 will all be served by a private water line that's on the property already.
Portland Water District does not have the authority, I guess, it's our understanding, to make any comments whether or not they have the ability to serve that, because they do not own the lines that go down to those lots. If on lot 10, for some reason, we did not use those that water sources on the property already, we have shown well locations and the plumes from the septic systems. On lot 8, we've also shown the nitrate plumes. What is listed as item number 7, the proposed drainage easement required in Fowler Road down here. We realize that because of the way the drainage is working off the Pomeroy Road construction, that there will be some drainage that comes from this area going to the north, going underneath Fowler Road, and extending down to a wetland on the other side. We will be providing a drainage easement. John Green will be making an appearance before the town council for conditional municipal approval for the drainage easement. And that, as far as we're concerned, are the items that really need to be addressed in terms of the review of completeness. I'm sure there's many other items having to do with the issues of the proposal, but for right now, we would take Maureen's advice and just stick with those for this discussion.
Thank you. Are there any questions from board members regarding comprehensiveness or necessary items for completeness of the application? Or any questions about the types of information that we could have the applicant address at this point? Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Yes.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sprague Corporation for final subdivision review, resource protection permit, and 4 private access waivers for a 62-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road be deemed complete.
Second, please.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion of the motion at this point by board members? Well, hearing no other questions, I would ask that all board members in favor of approval of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. And we have a unanimous vote that the application is complete. At this point in time, we can proceed into perhaps a more detailed series of questions, but also the board needs to have a discussion amongst itself about, at this point in time, whether or not another sidewalk is necessary or desirable for this project, and then also a discussion of scheduling a public hearing. Mr. Parkhurst.
Due to the sheer magnitude of this, even though I think we've all been on site, I really strongly feel there's so much material here, and trying to go through it all and try to be knowledgeable about the whole thing is virtually impossible without seeing it on the face of the earth. I really think we need to go out to the site again, and I think we should do it fairly soon so we don't do it in the same type of weather that we did last year. And as to a public hearing, I suppose we should, since this pretty much represents roughly 20% of the town of Cape Elizabeth in land area. I don't know if anything's going to be gained by it, but I think we should do it anyway.
Okay. Anybody else feel that would be a good idea?
I would agree with Steve. that the magnitude of the project is such that...
I think at this point, because the scope of actual work is now delineated in the documents, it might bear another trip through just saying, this is what is going to happen here and there, so that as we go through, if we could be shown where the actual areas of earthwork are, which, albeit, are in the package, but my memory of the site is not so detailed that I could find them without some type of a key plan or an overlay showing which sheet refers to which half-inch square on the overall plan.
If you recall last time when we did this sidewalk, or series of sidewalks, we had a chart which brought us through from one end to the other. And I guess if it's the will of the board, we would proceed along that same track and try and get those same highlights, look at representative areas of the road will be widened. We'll show you the very few areas where wetland fill may be required for road widening. We'll look at the fire ponds. We could look at the sites of the homes. Are there any other specific areas, now that you've had a chance to look at the whole package, that you feel that you need to have more detailed review or explanation?
I really think the high points that we've been discussing during the whole application are the things we really want to see. You know, the road widening, the road realignments, whatever is going to be down the roadways, the fire ponds, and I think revisit each cluster, if you will, or section of newly created lots that have no houses on them at this point. I think that would be very helpful. And it makes all of the plans seem much less onerous than they appear sitting here coiled and ready to bite, you know.
The question is when?
Well, let's, at this point in time, unfortunately it gets dark in the early evening, so I think probably the way we did it last time, back in the spring, you know, early in the morning, on the weekend is probably best approach. Is there any preference on the applicant's part in terms of weekends that would be better for us, or?
Just wear your blaze orange, I guess. We do it this month.
Blaze orange. Well.
Can we put everyone on one bus again, one vehicle again? I mean, is there any chance we could get this together this, like, for this Saturday?
My recommendation would be to try to schedule this as soon as possible. Saturday is what you've usually done, say 8 to 11, 9 to 12. The question is, are board members available this Saturday?
And the earlier the better. Speaking for myself.
Well, 8 o'clock Saturday sounds fine with me. From the board members. Before 8 o'clock, I think, would be.
I know I have a Falmouth Planning Board meeting at 9, but you can go on without me, and I'll join you later on.
A Saturday morning planning board meeting?
Sidewalk.
Oh, yeah.
Sidewalk. Oh. Okay.
From 8 to what?
I would imagine.
2 hours.
It would be 8 to 10. Would be a rough guess. Do you think that would be a good rough guess?
Say 8 to 11.
It's not like this is the first safe where you've been there. I mean, everyone's...
Yeah, we're not looking for bearings this time. We're looking for work. What the improvements are. So, since we're looking for the improvements instead of just trying to get an overall reading of the whole site, we could say 2 hours or three at the outside, I would imagine. But two should do it. Okay.
This Saturday.
Saturday morning, November 21st at 8 a.m.
Where do you want to meet?
Behind the town hall.
Thank you. Since there already is a documentation of work that is planned, could the itinerary, if you will, sort of merely at stops direct us to which sheet within the set of drawings pertains to where we are?
I ask that you bring your half-size sheets along.
If we bring our half-size sheets with us, and because the backup sheets which show the detailed grading and contours and improvements are all fairly legible at the half-size, figuring out which half-size sheet goes with which intersection on the overall plan, however, is a little more difficult. I mean, you can figure it out, but, or you could just tell us which page to turn to as we come around the corner or something, but that would be a big help. Does the board have any preferences on when to have the public hearing? Should we schedule that in right now for next month?
That's fine with me.
15th?
Yes.
Okay. So.
So we're doing it November 20th. Is that 21st?
This Saturday. So
this Saturday, November 21st, will be the site walk. And then the public hearing will be at our December 15th meeting.
At 8 a.m. Is that right?
Right, yep. Out back here. Hmm? Up behind here.
Those items being taken care of, are there any questions of the actual design or the application itself or discussion at this point which we wish to enter into? Yes.
One comment. this may not be a popular thing to say, but I really feel as though I'm going to be far better prepared to have constructive comments and questions once the site walk is done once again. I really spent a couple hours yesterday and probably an hour today going through this, and I finally just got to the point where my eyes were swimming. I need to go out and just see it, and then I'll come back and I'll have a mental list of questions or comments, as I think all of us will, and it'll make the process go much more quickly.
It really is a forest and trees situation at this point. Mm-hmm.
Did we look at the public access waivers last time we were there? Those seem to be sort of individual sort of pieces, some of them with on what may perhaps last time would have been existing structures which weren't singled out for new lots.
Right, I think that's a new part of the application, new
so
part
I
of the
think
discussion.
Those might be something that we could take a look at in the field also. As opposed to the sort of overall, that might take up a little bit more time, but would be good to look at. And hopefully we'll have good weather so that we can walk into those.
Do you have specific concerns at this point regarding the access waivers?
Well, I noticed that the application states that rules for the access waivers or something, the access waivers shall follow ordinance. But at any rate, I haven't looked closely enough at the documentation yet to look for exact whether or not there are associated road widenings or fire truck turnarounds or whatever associated.
I think that's probably an issue that we need to talk a little bit further with Maureen prior to the sidewalk.
Okay, because in terms of seeing how vehicles get in and out and whatnot, that is something that is important. Yes.
Well, I really don't want to open a can of worms tonight, but I wondered how you and your troops responded to the critique.
The 23 item, yes. Yes, there's a lot of comments
There's a lot of comments that Steve made.
There's a lot of what?
Comments.
Comments?
Yes.
Yes. And some of them, I mean, we can pass over.
Well, let me tell you briefly what we've done. Les Berry has gone through the list that we got from Steve Harney, and for each one of those, he's written a short response. And I probably a third of those, I think that we need to have more discussion with the planning board on, because they are issues. Some of them are substantive, some of them are fairly minor, but I think about a third of Steve's comments really need action on your part. At least that's our read of it. Some of them, we simply agree, they're simply observations or directives to add a note here or there. But on a few of them, we will have to talk to the board about the various options we've looked at and how we're handling the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there are a lot of comments. We'd like to think that for the 80 drawings, that's a ratio of one comment for every three pages of drawings. So I must applaud Steve for having the fortitude to go through it, and I think he did a very thorough job. He picked up a lot of things that we either overlooked in a couple of areas, but things that really needed to be brought out in the open for a more formal discussion. So I think he certainly served the town and us very well by his comments.
Okay.
And we are prepared to discuss every last one of them.
Okay.
And I guess that brings up a good point. How should we structure the public meeting, the public hearing next time in December? How broad of an overview do you want? How much detail do you think is necessary to go into in reviewing the application? We did give you a fairly lengthy package here, and we could spend 5 minutes with an overview or an hour going into a lot of detail. We certainly feel that a lot of Steve's comments require some work on the board's part. For example, this whole discussion about gravel. Well, that may be Steve's recommendation, but ultimately it's our understanding the board is going to make a decision about, you know, type A or type D or a mixture of the two types of gravel. I just use that as an example of the sort of points that he brings up.
Well, I assume we pay him for his advice, and so I think at least we should discuss some of his issues that he's brought up.
And we didn't know whether we're going to get into this tonight. That's why we have Les Berry here. We'll have Les at the next meeting with the planning board to discuss it from an engineering perspective.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why I said I didn't want to open up a can of worms.
At least not tonight.
Yeah.
At some point, we're going to have to face it.
Yeah.
And it's a question of when and in what level of detail. And I'd like to think also that maybe by talking with Steve, and we did try and get a hold of Steve, but I guess he's on his honeymoon right now, before he comes back, hopefully, you know, Les and we have had a chance to sit down with Steve and offer our view on his comments.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully we'll be able to pare this list down to something.
Yeah, well, some of them he sort of admits.
As our checkoffs,
you know. But, and some of them overlap. Some of his comments overlap.
That's right.
So I think they could be reduced a great deal.
Right.
Maybe next mm-hmm. time we would be geared up to ask the questions that we think are pertinent. And by that time, you might have agreed to some of his suggestions yourselves.
We have already.
Conceded, you know. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Maureen has some information for us, I believe.
Well, I am the beneficiary of Steve's annotated draft copy, as well as the final copy. And what he's done in the margin is highlighted the areas that specifically require a decision by the board. And if you want, I can just read through those numbers right now if you want to mark up your copy of the town engineer's letter. Starting on page 1, number 2, road signs. And he's also suggested where departments should be commenting, and in this case, you have a letter from the Public Works Department addressing that issue. Number three, stop signs. Number four, paved apron areas. These are all decisions that the board needs to make a decision on.
Unless...
He's giving you his recommendation.
Unless...
The applicant is willing to comply with...
The applicant concedes.
Right, because what the town engineer has done is made a recommendation based on what the standards are in the ordinance and his professional judgment.
Yeah.
And if you want to do something other than what he's recommending, you have authority to do that, but you have to explicitly state it. Number eight, the gravel sections is something...
So nothing on five, six, seven?
Right.
Eight.
He's recommending that on number nine, that's a major issue that you need to deal with, is what extent Pomeroy Road should be designed. Number 10 is the same as number nine. It's what extent Coot Lane should be designed. He's suggesting the number 12, the lower River Road guardrail. Number 13, the letter of credit. Going to page three. Number 19, the monumentation. Number 20, Ice Pond Road. And number 21, Pomeroy Road. Again, this is to what extent the road has to be built as part of facing. And those are the ones that he has highlighted that really do require some explicit decision by the planning board.
That's very similar to our list, but not exact.
You agree. Is that what you said? You agree?
Well, we agree that...
These need to be addressed.
He added one to the list that we had, and he didn't catch two that we thought that probably needed some more discussion with the board.
Are there any other items that board members could request clarifications on in terms of intent or not getting into the deeper details at this point?
Just a quick question. The copy of the fax page we have from Monahan Leahy, condition of approval plan, was that, who drafted that?
Just prior to the submission by the applicant, there had been discussion throughout the whole process about the board's expectation that if lots were going to be sold to the public, that there would be an additional review by the planning board. The applicant drafted a note, provided a copy to me, I provided a copy to the town attorney for review, and we both made some changes to it. So the fax copy that you have is his revision of the original proposal by the applicant. And it was, we basically worked on it together. I agree with the town attorney's recommendation.
I think in terms of just a perspective which I had, which in terms of the language that was alluded to earlier having been changed, there was a note which seemed redundant, because it very simply at the end said that these areas are available for use by family members. And in addition, and the way it has been presented so far in the plans, it may mean the same thing, but what it says instead is subsequent to the bylaws of the Sprague Corporation and the Black Point Corporation, which none of the board members have any idea what those bylaws are. Whereas the earlier language in the condition of approval just said family members get to use these areas. But if in your correspondence with our town attorney it boils down to meaning the same thing, then that's fine. But it was just something that kind of went over my head.
Those are really two different notes we're talking about.
Two different notes completely.
Yeah. Yeah, one is access to the common grounds.
Right.
The other has to do with sale of lots.
Okay.
And how that would trigger additional review by the planning board.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Can I make a suggestion and possibly a motion? It seems that I get a sense that there's a reservation of any of the board members wanting to get into a really sort of deep discussion tonight. And I, for one, I think would, like as I said earlier, to have the site walk or site, and then start at the next meeting. So following that, I'd like to make a motion.
Yes, Steve.
Be it further ordered that the application be tabled to the regular December 15th, 1998 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion for the applicant at this point? Or
any further items? Directives as to how much detail?
Or questions or anything which we would like to see to help us over the next month?
Well, I think we've already given suggestions.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I mean, the way the application has gone, I think the applicant has been very responsive to our questions or whatever. And if we have further clarification of the points that you had mentioned earlier in the site walk, I think we'll be in good shape.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, well, hearing no further discussion then, all those in favor of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. And we have a unanimous motion, tabling till next month, but we will look forward to seeing you sooner.
Saturday
morning, bright and early. Maureen?
Thank you very much.
I'd just like to make one request. If any of the board members between now and Saturday go over the plans and see anything in particular you would like to see on the site walk, if you could call me and let me know, and that way I can get that information to the applicant.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stewing most of it.
You're Saturday off, Tom.
No, I don't. Just meet up in the door.
Oh, you have to judge what? A speech?
Yeah, speech to meet up in the room. Volunteer.
Which would you rather do?
Rather go outside.
The next item on our agenda is the tower zoning amendments. A request by the Town Council for the Planning Board to make a recommendation for amendments to the zoning ordinance regulating telecommunication facilities under section 19-10-3, zoning amendments. At this point in time, I think it may perhaps be good for us to take an overview of this. And I think Maureen might be able to at least sort of tell us what has transpired to date, what we're involved with, and what we're attempting to do with this.
Certainly. In 1996, the federal government passed the new Telecommunications Act, which the end result is that there is going to be a significant construction of new towers throughout the United States over the next 10 years. There's been sales of licenses in many markets, including our own, and there are going to be up to five competitors trying to provide additional both cellular communications and PCS communications. The town, the Planning Board, has experienced some of this already with a couple of applications for new antenna. And what the Town Council decided to do was to create, at the recommendation of the Planning Board, I might add, a telecommunications facility task force, of which Mr. Carter was the Planning Board's representative. They reviewed the whole issue and have made a series of recommendations on regulations of new telecommunications towers and amateur telecommunication facilities. Their recommendations are consistent with the federal requirements while still providing the town some opportunity to review these facilities and regulate how they're placed in the community. Those zoning recommendations were forwarded to the planning board. The board has met during several workshops reviewing those, and what you have tonight in front of you is the final draft of all your discussions. The most recent changes to this draft are two comments that were made at the last workshop by the planning board. One, there was concern about the use of the word camouflage in the alternative tower definition. I have decided that there was a board member who was absolutely correct, and we have eliminated the word camouflage from the definition and relying on the word conceal to explain the concept of being able to place an antenna within an existing structure so that you cannot tell that the antenna is there. Further, there was a request to not allow new towers to be ahead of an existing structure that is placed in the front yard setback. So in addition to the 125% of the height setback that is already being proposed, there's been an additional setback requirement that requires that any new tower has to be setback at least 5 feet from the front edge of an existing structure. So that's the only two new additions. Everything else is basically what you've seen before, regulating, allowing basically tower facilities where they can be camouflaged or concealed throughout the community, proposing two new what we call tower overlay districts where new commercial towers may be constructed. And that tower overlay district does also set up the mechanism for the council to establish other tower overlay districts if it's become necessary and at the application of a property owner. Third, there is a whole series of new regulations of amateur wireless communications that allow some freedom if you're not going beyond a certain point, and then a graduated level of review by the code enforcement officer, and finally the planning board, the higher and more extensive an amateur facility becomes in an existing neighborhood. Any questions?
Mr. Emery.
As you know, I have some background in this area, but I probably missed more of the workshops than I attended on this item. And my ignorance will show that. But we've dropped camouflage out of the definition, but it's repeated throughout the text. Should it be deleted throughout the text as well? For example, on page 5 and 6. And it's the same paragraph, the same sentence, but on page 5, line 10.
And that's we can delete it.
Okay. With respect to the front yard setback, as you know, I have two towers across the street from me that have never been a problem. There has been a problem. The neighbor has been more than willing to try to deal with any interferences. But I've become very familiar with what it takes to hold those things up. There's a main tower, and then there's antennas, or whatever the right term is, booms that come off. So they can be fairly sizable, depending upon one's ability to invest in the radio system. But the guy wires come into the front yard, and I don't know that this ordinance specifically refers to that issue, and it frankly just occurred to me as I was sitting here, and that's why I bring it up. And the reason I'm bringing that up, because this ordinance, I don't know if we all realize it, but if Steve wants to put a 50-foot radio tower in his side yard tomorrow, he can go to the code enforcement officer, pay a building permit fee, sign a form, and start construction of a 50-foot tower. If he wants a 51-foot tower, then it's a whole different ballgame. But I hope we all understand that. Do we all understand that is my question. 50-foot tower. We all understand that. We all understand that anywhere in the town of Cape Elizabeth within the zones indicated, including the most dense zones, if I live in Oakhurst neighborhood and I can put a 50-foot tower up as long as I have a yard that's, whatever the math is, 150 feet wide, pop that in my backyard without site plan review, without zoning board review, and without any other review, just as if I were putting a small addition on the back of my garage. We all understand that. I think there's something fundamentally wrong with that, but I'm late in the game, and I'm not going to go against the tide that's already dealt with this issue. For whatever reason, I think 50 feet is excessive. I just think that it's asking, I can't imagine going down any street in Cape Elizabeth and seeing 50-foot towers built at will in people's backyards, but that's, and once again, I have probably two towers of similar height across the street from me. Visually, they're not obtrusive. Everyone who comes by my house notices them immediately. I get along very well with a neighbor. I see them every day, so I'm used to them. But I just think if people in Cape Elizabeth realized that, it would be very interesting to meet a neighbor who, I mean, we had concern about people getting building permits and not notifying abutters, which we all agree should never happen. But I think it would be very interesting the day that a 50-foot radio tower pops up in somebody's backyard and all they've done is gone and got a building permit. I just, particularly if the same boom antennas get placed on them as have been placed on the ones in my neighborhood. One other more constructive comment. In the definition, should we define, is the FCC the correct federal communication, whatever federal agency that regulates? And again, that's, I should have called if I thought that was an issue, but it just occurred to me as I was sitting here.
We can add that.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Question for Maureen. Do we have any idea how many towers there are presently in the town?
Yes. As part of the work of the Telecommunications Facility Committee, we attempted to inventory towers, and it's a little difficult because you're basically mentally walking through town remembering everything that you've seen. There's a tower at Two Lights State Park, and that's the cement tower, not an actual tower. There's a tower, I believe, in addition to the water tower on Avon Road in Shore Acres. There are two towers in Fort Williams. There's also a small tower, actually not so small, at the public safety building across the street on Ocean House Road. There's a tower owned by Murray Construction off of Shore Road right near the town hall. There's another tower owned by Gerald Murray across the street from the town hall. There's a tower on Mr. Emery's street on Juniper Lane. There's another tower 90 feet high on Stonegate Road off of Mitchell Road. We have a total of six towers located at 351 Spurwink Ave. We have a windmill at Bothell's Garage. I wouldn't call that a tower, but that's part of our inventory. There probably are some small ones that we don't have.
So if my count is correct, we have 16 towers in the town.
Roughly.
And six of those are in one location.
Right.
There are 10 scattered throughout the rest of the town.
Right.
I bring this up because I hear what you're saying loud and clear, and I have the same concerns you do, but I think, if anything, there's going to be a lessening of people wanting towers, given the advance in the electronics and et cetera. So if we only have 10 now, I think probably we'll see actually a lesser number as time goes on, which I kind of hope happens.
Yes.
Was this discussed in the committee? And there was an overwhelming desire for the freedom to have a tower where you wanted to have it.
Within these guidelines, yes.
I don't know, maybe Maureen should probably explain this. I'm not sure if I'll get it correctly, but this whole zoning ordinance for the tower amendments is been precipitated by sort of the changing world we're living in. But we're also, and this is where you're going to have to jump in, I can't remember what all the prior things are that led up to this, but we are basically being forced to do this more than anything else.
It was the federal 1996 Telecommunication Act which really put this on the front burner. And for communities in Maine that front on Route 95 or Route 1, they have, you've probably seen in the newspaper, been under tremendous amounts of pressure to approve towers of significant height. What the Federal Telecommunication Act says is that a community cannot ban towers. You cannot do it. It's considered unfair practices. You cannot discriminate between different carriers. And if you think of the fact that, you know, there are five carriers out there with licenses to serve the Cape Elizabeth area, we've got to provide an opportunity for these people to locate. If we do not select the areas, we will eventually be sued, and the areas will be selected for us. I believe that because Cape Elizabeth doesn't have frontage along those major roads that run through the state of Maine, that we have not been under the pressure that towns like Freeport and Kennebunk have been under. But it's only a matter of time. The other thing that's pressuring us is right now, up until this time, people have been looking at cellular communication, which is analog, and that has a more powerful signal, which, dependent on topography, can travel 10 miles. So that the existing tower at 351 Spurwink Ave in Cape Elizabeth essentially can serve the entire community. There are a few places where we don't get coverage, but for the most part, it's adequate. But the wave of the future is PCS technology, which is digital technology. It provides more services than the current cellular technology. You can transfer data over it. You can use fax machines. It's on a higher wave band. It is a weaker signal. And therefore, again, depending on topography, the signal radius is about 2 miles. So where we were able to provide coverage for the entire town with one tower site under the cellular type technology, we're now looking at needing 2 to 4 sites for the PCS technology. What the Telecommunications Facility Committee did is they decided, first of all, that we don't want to have a proliferation of these towers, and that we should use the existing tower site in Spurwink Ave and try to find out where the areas of town where we don't have coverage that can already provide. What we found is that the southern part of town and the northeastern part of town cannot be reached by that tower based on our crude analysis. And again, our analysis could not take into consideration topographical changes. We just looked at a general two-mile radius. That's why the new tower overlay district is proposed for the shore area, shore acres, water tower area. It was felt that that one location could probably provide coverage for most of that southern part of Cape Elizabeth. There is still an area where coverage is not anticipated by the Spray Corporation, but the idea there is that it's such a lightly, sparsely populated area, it'll be a long time before anyone is looking to provide coverage there, and hopefully you'll be able to use the alternative tower technology, where you can incorporate antennas in existing tall structures instead of having to build a new tower. The other area of town where we still don't have pretty good coverage is the northeastern part of Cape Elizabeth. And the hope is there that the existing facilities that exist in South Portland will be able to serve the very northern portion. And then again, once you get over the ridge and you head down the hill from Shore Road and you don't get that coverage from the South Portland facilities, that we'll be able to use alternative tower technology instead of having to erect a new tower. It's probably more than you wanted to know.
No, but it's not. I think actually the reason why I had to do that, I think if anyone is actually watching this, they would like to know why we're doing this, because it probably doesn't make any sense.
The other complication in the town of Cape Elizabeth is in most communities like Portland and Kennebunk and to some extent Freeport, they have made towers permitted or conditional use in their industrial and commercial zones. We do not have that opportunity in Cape Elizabeth because we don't have any industrial zones, and we have extremely limited commercial zones that would not provide sufficient coverage for the town. So we've got to find a way to incorporate these structures within our existing zoning.
Yes.
Maureen, I want to thank you. You put it in context.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Mr. Wilcox?
Yes.
If I may also, if I could expand on the question that Nancy asked of me. When the task force was originally charged by the council, we were basically told to be concerned only with telecommunications, basically the cell phone industry. We took it upon ourselves to expand that into amateur radio communication, and had we not done that, there would be no regulations whatsoever concerning privately owned amateur radio towers. You could build whatever you wanted to on any lot, as long as you could safely do it engineering-wise. So this is a good first step, and because I don't think any member of the task force or any member of this board has a great deal of knowledge in radio communications towers, we have to try something. I think this is a reasonable regulation that will allow us to allow the industry to operate in town within reasonable controls.
And hopefully something new will be
I agree. I think
designed.
Technology will make
it's
this.
It's all going so quickly that we may look back in 10 years and laugh at this.
Well, if you look at some of the original communications towers of a decade or two ago that were basically concerned with relaying telephone lines, they looked like something out of Star Wars. They were monstrosities on the landscape. Mm-hmm. Now we've gone down to dishes that are 18-inch mm-hmm. across. So it's getting better and less intrusive.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Please.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that be it ordered that the zoning ordinance power amendments and comprehensive plan power amendments be tabled to the regular December 15th, 1998 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing should be held.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any